Well, there are some Puffy treats. This actually like bears a similarity to my review. Okay, Puffy, well, like because I used an idea. So, Puffy treats. When I received a telegram from my Uncle Minnie revealing me desperately ill, I packed a suitcase at once and started downtown in search of Puffy treats. I had not seen Uncle Minnie in years, but my passion for Puffy treats remained as sharp and unabated as ever. Though undoubtedly, I better stating the case than calling it a mere passion. In reality, it was more, much more ravening, even a natural hunger that raged inside me night and day and had to be assuaged constantly, else I ran the risk of becoming depleted and run down. No deprivation is greater. Deprivation. Months later, after my uncle's funeral, which needless to say, I had been unable to attend owing to my never-ending search for treats. I received another telegram, the one informing me I had inherited his farm. My first impulse was to get out of my urban slum apartment and move back to the ancestral home, but on reflection, I changed my mind. Or rather, I let the matter of the farm slip my mind completely. I'm afraid again, it was my hunger for sweet treats that overmastered my best intentions, driving me as it did repeatedly into the streets where I prowl like some wild, clinging, insatiable, about altogether lost, as it were, to reason. And why not? After all, no less an important visionary historical personage than G.I. Gurdjieff, when visiting his family, would, it is said, divide his time between Alexandropol and Baku towns, both noted for their puffy treats. Kurchov was drawn to by code and to attend meetings of the PT boys, the most encouraging society, which made it a practice to journey frequently into the Gobi Desert in search of puffy treats buried beneath the sand. This practice was so futile that only the greatest devotees of could be persuaded to take part in it if at all. Usually it was just Gurdjieff and Kiki, the dancing boy, who would take part in anything. These experiences encumbered and limited Gurdjieff's adult sexual function, his single-minded devotion to ferrying out puffy treats made it difficult for him to approach a girl with any feeling or unease or even interest. When the necessity for a new sexual relationship became evident after the breakup of one of his inevitably short-lived love affairs, Gurdjieff showed more inclination to seek out puffy treats than to seek out any new romantic interest. And his habitual involvement with puffy treats definitely interfered with him having anal intercourse with a man. This was only to be expected, one so incessantly bent on seeking out puffy treats couldn't very well indulge in anal intercourse, and anal intercourse couldn't very well indulge in puffy treats. Since it has no stomach, Gurdjieff's sex life. Therefore, pretty much was given over to his devotion to puffy treats, to which he was so attached that when he caught a case of scop claw rash from brewing without his socks, and had to remain indoors for days on end, immobilized in bed with his breath of Puffy treats. The nearest Puffy treats were Baku, 30 miles away. He suffered a nervous breakdown. And suffering a nervous breakdown when you're the type of person who is already spending your every waking moment obsessing over Puffy treats, there is always one consolation. No matter how bizarre you get to act after your breakdown, it isn't likely to be much noticed. About the only person to remark on the oddness of Gertrude's post-breakdown behavior with his friend, P.D. Ospinski, who pointed out how Gertrude had taken to writing highly untoward things in his journal. Ospinski's reaction to this was to go to Gertrude and say, please stop writing in my journal. Among the journal entries made by Gurdjieff at the time were notations such as, I found the following morning throughout the previous night, and yet men of knowledge know how to retain the fine matters in themselves only a large accumulation of these Puffy treats enables a second and lighter body to be formed within man. Or do I mean formed? No, I guess formed is right. It is as if his continual, unsleeping desire to accumulate Puffy treats, a man should visualize himself as standing 3 feet behind his own neck, something that then could be repeated so that he visualizes himself standing 3 feet behind himself, visualizing himself standing 3 feet behind his own neck, so to speak. And from there on is the work of but a moment until he visualizes himself standing 3 feet behind himself, visualizing himself standing 3 feet behind himself, visualizing himself standing 3 feet behind himself, his own neck, etc., etc. Gurdjieff's name for this process was backwards visualization. He could go on about it on Spinski's journal for pages, and did, especially when he was having to stay in bed without his Puffy treats. One day when he had been in bed for about 2 weeks and was so full of hunger and longing for Puffy treats that he couldn't see straight, Gurdjieff demanded to put his own theory to the test. He was going here under the assumption that if he managed to visualize himself as standing behind himself enough times, which is to say enough times in succession, his lighter body would eventually form a line and back up far enough behind himself to reach Baku, where he could find a future. Here's the toe. Gurdjieff had never managed more than 2 or 3 backwards visualizations of any one sitting because of how easily he was distracted, thinking so much about Puffy treats the way he did was of course a major distraction, but now his hunger for Puffy treats spurred him on. He sat up in his bed and felt him visualizing with a wheel flat out. After about 10 minutes of supreme effort, he had reached stage where he was visualizing himself as standing 3 feet behind himself, his own neck, which came to 7 visualizations in a row for a total of 21 feet or 1/199th of a mile. Needless to add, this meant that there were 30 miles or 188,400 feet or 62,800 visualizations still left to go before his lighter body could hope to back up far enough behind himself to reach Baku and find Puffy treats. The 7 visualizations he had so far accomplished barely got him out of the house and into the driveway. Whether Virchow would have succeeded in completing his remaining 62,800 backwards visualization is something we will never know, because in moving backwards the way he was, his vision was limited, and he was inadvertently caught with a dog in that was lying in the driveway. Trotting unexpectedly on the dog end caused him to lose concentration in a hurry, so that like an overstretched girdle snapping back on itself, he reversed direction and came rocking forward through the 7 successive visualizations of himself, with the result that his lighter body, the one that had been last in line, impacted, that his lighter body, the one that had impacted, snapped against his physical body. The one sitting up in his bed doing the visualization, with a shout that traveled far into the next panel, a sort of John Updike hell or pocket universe, where somebody named Griffin squealed in ecstasy and cried, "Oh, Krupman, how do you do, go on?" and jab somebody named Virginia in the arm so hard, Herbert Carrington jumped from her hand and bubbled across the Formica table. Gertrude gazed over their heads in pain. Much like a wounded camel, he came to despise that world. No puffy treats to speak of. No puffy treats. Just a world seen and described and interpreted by a subtle poetic intellectual wandering. Didn't take much of this before Gorgeous vast, frustrated longing for something as unpoetic and nonsensious as puffy treats. Indeed, his very self seemed to crawl into the long dark space thus created, the shriveled, beaten, displaced person. This is why it is never a wise thing to use backwards visualizations when you go seeking after puffy treats, or to trot on a dog end in the driveway.